Name of the Father, the sorry, the you might have remembered the same theme of this Sunday as that of last Sunday. And the whole month is focused on the Holy Bible and its works in our lives. And the first two Sundays are about how the Holy Bible dwells in us, the seed of the Word of God that dwells in our hearts, that so that we may bear fruit 30, 60, and 100-fold. And the church has related the readings to our daily life, especially in Egypt, when this is the time of the harvest or sowing seeds after the flooding of the Nile. So the church arranged the readings to remind them how God is the source and Pantocrator and the one who they seek in all aspects of their life. And as you know, the parable of the sower, which is mentioned today in the Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 13, and last Sunday, the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 8, and last Saturday, the Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 4. The Lord actually, in the other Gospels besides the Gospel of today, he explains the parable to his disciples in detail. So we won't go into the explanation, but as we know, the sower of the seed is the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who went out in a sense of heaven to sow the word of God in the hearts of his children. The seed is the word of God and the soil is the heart, and there's different types of hearts. But we'll focus on the thorny ground, which seems to be most prevalent today. The Lord describes this in the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 8 from last Sunday. Now the ones that fell among the thorns are those who, when they heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. And in last Saturday's Gospel, now these are the ones sown among thorns. They are the ones who hear the word and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and desires for other things enter in, choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. And it seems like this is probably more of the common struggle or temptation that we Christians face today, because we might not necessarily be by the wayside or on the stony ground, but we begin to bear fruit. But because we say that the three causes that the Lord gives to us, we remember them by CPR, it's the opposite of CPR, but we'll get into that in a minute. The cares, the pleasures, and the riches of this life, those are the things that choke us and cause us to worry or to have anxiety. And even if you look at that word in itself, it means to choke up. If you even look at the most common psychological disorder or problem that people have, even who are not distressed, but they have a common problem in their life, this is the stress or the anxiety or the worry. And even the Lord says in last night's Gospel, according to St. Luke chapter 12, he says, do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink or have an anxious mind. So a lot of us have anxious minds, especially in our culture, it seems to be more common. But the Lord recognizes this. And in the Gospel, many, many times, he reminds us of the fact that we worry too much. meaning, like we said, to choke. And for example, when we even look at the different stages of our life, we have reason to worry. Like when we are very young, when we're babies or toddlers, we worry about being loved and being cared for and having our needs met. And if they're not met, you know, things don't go well, as you know. And when we get older, we worry about the same things, but we worry about, are we getting the love and the respect from our parents? And then when we get a little older, like in the junior high age, we worry less about the respect and love from our parents, because most of us, thank God, we have it, but we worry more about that from our friends and those around us to gain respect from, so we try to copy them and to fit in. Then when we get older, we worry about our education a little more, getting the right grades, taking the SATs, getting into the college that we want, finding the major that we want, what career will we get. Then we worry about finding a spouse and the right job, and then we worry about keeping that job. Then we worry about, okay, am I going to get married? Am I going to have kids? Can I have kids? Then when we have kids, we worry about the kids for the same thing. So life is full of things that we can be worried and anxious about. Even when we look at the spiritual life, if we're not careful, we can begin to worry about sin and not get anywhere spiritually. So many times our worrying about these things lead us to lose them completely or not get the goal that we want. And this is the greatest fear, because anxiety is fear usually about the future, or and it's an intense emotional distress that interferes with our functioning in daily life for at least some time. Many people who worry too much, you find them, they can't sleep, or they can't rest, or they can't even make a decision that they're worried about. So they're worried so much about making the right decision, they can't make a decision at all. So this, I'm sure many of us experience this, even the ones who are close to God. So what do we do? Because the Lord says, don't worry, or don't have an anxious mind. So just to be brief, we have three also basic responses, also with CPR. The first one is we focus on the confidence that we have in God, casting our care upon Him, and the concern for others. We put to God our requests in prayer, and we have patience for Him to work. And then finally, we contemplate on the redemption that we have in the Lord, and we seek the eternal life. So we'll go briefly into these three points. The first one is confidently casting our care on Him. And this is basically having faith. If you look at the source or what anxiety is, it's a sign that we have little faith. And this is why the Lord says, why are you fearful or anxious, O you of little faith? So just like the thorns choke up the seed and prevent them from bearing fruit for a long time, so worry and anxiety and stress chokes our faith. So we find that even though we might have faith, but we begin to worry too much, our faith decreases. Then we are prevented from bearing fruit, or good fruit to God. But the Lord, in many places in the gospel, we don't have time to mention all of them, and in many of the Psalms, God is trying to comfort us and console us and to encourage us not to worry. Like when he was giving his disciples one of his last instructions, he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So we have to take these words and apply them to our life. Let our hearts not be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Part of the problem is that we can be concerned with certain aspects in our life, in our mind. But when our mind gets carried away, it affects our heart. And God does not want our heart to be troubled or afraid of anything. And this is why the Psalms say, cast your burden on the Lord, and He will sustain you. And another place, St. Peter says, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. So we cast all our anxiety on the Lord. Why? Because He is anxious for our souls. He's not anxious in the same way. He cares for us, as St. Peter says. We cast our care on God because He cares for us. And this is how we confidently cast our care on Him. The second thing is we also care for those who are in need. So we are concerned for others. And this is the mind of Christ. Just like God worries and cares about us, we have to worry about others. And this is the service. When St. Paul endured many hardships for the sake of the service of God, in 2 Corinthians, he gives a long list of many of the things that he went through. For example, and each one of these has, if it happened to us, we would spend a long time worrying about it. He says, from the Jews five times I received 40 stripes minus one. Just like the Lord was flogged before the cross, St. Paul endured this five different times. Three times I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, three times I was shipwrecked, a night and day I have been in deep, in journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea. So he's saying, no matter where I go, no matter what I do, I have all of these problems. But then when he gets to the end, it's a much longer list. He says, besides all the other things that comes upon me daily, my deep concern for the churches. So basically, in a way, he's saying, because I have so much care for the churches and the people and the salvation of others, all of these things don't move me because I'm worried more about my salvation and the salvation of others. So when we begin to learn to love and to serve others, our personal anxiety for our own things become that voice that is the voice of worry becomes to soften and quieten, and we're more concerned about our salvation and serving others. And this is what St. Paul talks about in the Pauline epistle of today. He says, God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. So he's saying, because you're serving others, God is not going to forget you. This is why we have to make it a point in our life not just to focus on ourselves. Because if we do, we're going to worry about the things of ourselves. But if we focus upon those others who are in need, many people will find that they forgot even the problems in their life, or they're not concerned of it because their heart is going out for others. The second aspect, as we said, is prayer. And if you think about, and this is not just any type of prayer, but the real deep personal relationship that we have with God. If we truly pray in the right way, then our anxiety will decrease. As St. Paul says in the book of the Philippians, chapter 4, he says, be anxious for nothing, or don't worry about anything, but in everything with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So saying, because we have anxiety over things, our hearts and our minds are not protected. They're not guarded. So what you have to do is pray. And he gives three different types of prayers here. He says the prayer, which is basically the lifting up of the mind and the heart to God. And then the supplication, which is putting our requests before God, like the litanies we have in the liturgy. And then the thanksgiving, which, as you know, we start every prayer in the church after our Father with the thanksgiving prayer. So if we learn to thank him for the things that we have before we get worried about the things that we need, and if we begin just to worship God in contemplating on his greatness and his holiness, like, for example, in the Synaxar today, we commemorate who? First, the four incorporeal creatures who carry the throne of God. So if we just think about how they do this and how close to God they are, and think about heaven, then our worries in this life will be diminished. So with prayer or worshiping God in its truth, putting our supplications before God, and thanking him for what we do have, then our hearts and our minds will be guarded, and the peace of God will be in our hearts. So the more we pray in this way, the less we will worry. And that's why the Lord says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. And this is what we say, cast your burden on the Lord and He will sustain you. But when we pray, we have to pray with patience. Like, for example, when St. Paul had something that prevented him from serving and he was caring about the people of God, he prayed. But he prayed 3 times and God didn't answer. So he understood this is God's will and he had to accept it. So many times we pray in the right way, but we don't get the answer that we expect. And this is why if we cast our care upon Him, for He cares for us, then whatever the result is, we still trust in Him and follow Him. And He answers in the right season, if He answers. I mean, if He answers the way we want. The psalm says, the Lord upholds all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look expectantly to You, and You give them their food in due season. Sound familiar? We say this in the Divine Liturgy. You open Your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. So God gives us our food in due season. He gives us what we need at the right time. Sometimes we want too many things, but these are not the things we need. Like we say, you know, God gives us everything we need, but not everything we want. So we have to take care when we put our requests before God, that we're asking for the things that we really need, not the physical things, but the spiritual things. That's why he says, seek first the kingdom of God. And this is the last point. We focus on the kingdom of God and our redemption and the salvation that the Lord God has given us through his sacrifice. like we say, when Adam and Eve tried to cover up their sin, they used the leaves of the tree by which they sinned. And God was not pleased with this. And he punished Adam, in a sense, by causing him to work by planting. This was part of the repercussions of his sin. And Cain tried to offer the sacrifice from this thing. And that's one reason why his offering was not accepted, because part of the punishment of Adam was that he was going to, in a sense, be a gardener or to plant. And so Cain planted and he offered this as an offering to God. And in the book of Genesis, God says, you know, cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life, both thorns and thistles it shall bring for you. So these thorns and thistles, in a sense, are what we are talking about here, the worry and the cares of the life. But what do we do with the thorns? We give them to the Lord. He puts them on his head. So we don't worry about it, but he says he will worry about these things. Take the thorns out of your heart and give them to the Lord, and he put them as a crown on his head. And this is why the sacrifice of Abel was accepted, because he gave the best and he gave everything. He gave the blood of the Lamb. And this was a type of Christ. So how do we deal with our problems, even the problem of sin? We don't try to cover it up like Adam did, but we give it to the Lord. We reveal it to the Lord. We don't make excuses for ourselves like Cain did. We don't blame others like the devil did, even like Adam did. But we take the seed of the word, we put it in our heart, we water it with the blood of Christ, and we give the thorns of the cares of this world to the Lord, and we contemplate on the things of God, especially the sacrifice of the cross. When we contemplate on the sacrifice of the cross, we won't worry too much, because nothing that we experience is in comparison to the cross. Why? We may suffer a lot, but we're sinners, and part of the suffering, and maybe most of the suffering, we deserve. But the Lord Jesus Christ, who is without sin, he didn't deserve any suffering because he is without sin. That doesn't mean all of the suffering we experience is because of sin, but we, as humble servants of God, can take it as that, so we remember our sins. And when we look at to the cross, we are comforted, because the Lord is suffering for us and for his love on us. So to conclude, We don't worry about the cares and the pleasures and the riches of the life, because this causes more worry. And actually, if you find the people, when they get more rich, they get more worried. So we don't ask for these things, because most likely they're going to cause more anxiety. But we do three things. We put our confidence or our care in Him and our concern for others. Secondly, we put to God all of our concerns in the true deep prayer, asking Him to provide. And we are patient. And then finally, we focus on our redemption, which is in Christ through the cross, in which He carries all of our worries on top of His head. May the Lord give us the patience and the peace that surpasses all understanding, and guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. And glory be to the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, now and forever, to age always.